Hello everyone, this is International Grandmaster Nadezhda Kosintseva for chesslectures.com, and today I would like to analyze for you one of my favorite classical games between two former world chess champions. This game was played between Vasily Smyslov and Mikhail Tal. The game started with first c4 move, so-called English system. So white demonstrates that he does not want to go into a theoretical discussion and prefers to begin with less aggressive opening. And black proceeded with g6. As usually, Tal demonstrates that he likes to develop the pieces on active positions. He tries to fight for the initiative from the beginning moves, and many systems in which black develops his dark squared bishop to the long diagonal promise black pretty active play. So white continues with knight c3, bishop g7, and g3. So standard choice for the English system. White brings his light squared bishop to the long diagonal to better control the center, to press on the b7 pawn. And then Tal proceeded with c5. So it blocks the white c-pawn, allows black to expand on the queen side, and black also takes control over the center, specifically over the d4 square. So the pawn structure becomes pretty symmetric. White continues with bishop g2, knight c6, and b3. One more time, white tries to avoid main lines. White just develops the pieces, moves the pieces out. Now he wants his another bishop to go to the long diagonal, and white does not castle so far. And one of the ideas behind this setup, maybe white does not want to castle at all. Sometimes white keeps the king in the middle of the board and plans to attack black on the side, pushing his pawns forward. So let's see what happened next. Black proceeded with e6. It clears the e7 square for the knight. As we will see, black the knight to e7, and in doing so he does not block his dark squared bishop. Knight can go to f5 from e7. And another idea behind this move, black plans to do d5 at some point, and d5 would help him to restrict the white's light squared bishop and just establish control over the middle of the board. Bishop b2, knight g e7, and at this point Smyslov played knight a4. In my opinion, not the best move. First of all, white brings the knight to the corner of the board. It's not forever, it's temporarily. Actually, knight attacks the c5 pawn, and in the case of bishop b2, knight b2, knight can pretty quickly go to the middle of the board, I mean knight d3. But still, I believe white is not ready, and knight would be better on e4. So instead of knight a4, if you like to play this position for white, I would suggest to try queen c1. It's pretty tricky move, looks maybe a little bit slow or passive, but has a very interesting idea behind it. White may have some tactical tricks with knight e4 or even knight d5 later on. For instance, if black plays something like d6, white can consider knight e4, offering a bishop trade, but now knight is in the middle. Knight can attack the d6 pawn and also aims at the f6 square. In the case of bishop b2, queen takes back, and white still occupies the long diagonal. Now with the queen, black cannot castle because of knight f6, and the black king is in a big danger. Or alternatively to knight e4, knight d5, this move works as well, because white just made a discovered attack. If black takes the knight with his knight or with his pawn, he loses the dark squared bishop. It's a big achievement for white if he can take the black's dark squared bishop. It can point out the serious weakening of the dark squares that black created playing g6. Or, again, in the case of bishop b2, queen takes back, and still white has an idea to bring his knight to f6. Still, black cannot take the d5 knight because now his rook is hanging. So white, again, seems to have pretty interesting position and can attack black on the dark squares. Instead of d6, black can castle, but still knight e4. And again, it can be played with the tempo. Knight takes c5, the main threat. Also, knight can go to d6 or f6 squares. So, queen c1 is for me pretty interesting move. And yeah, if you want to avoid long theoretical discussions, but try to be active, it can be a good choice for you. So, let's go back to the game. In the game, white decided to trade the bishops immediately. Knight a4. Black to the bishop, knight takes, and then black just castles. So black seems to have some little development. He castled first, but at the same time, the position is pretty closed. White can castle pretty quickly if he wishes. Maybe white does not want to castle. As I said earlier, sometimes white prefers to keep the king in the middle and can consider a pawn storm on the king side, h4, h5. It deserves consideration, especially when black develops the knight on e7 compared to the knight on f6. Black has less control over the king side squares, specifically the h5 square is less controlled when black brings the knight to e7. However, in the game, white did not even try to attack the black king. White continued his development. e3, and black played d5, so Tal plays aggressively. It's actually a very logical decision. Black tries to point out his little development. Black occupies the center since white did not bring any pawns to the middle of the board yet. And after knight f3, knight f5. So far so good. Again, looks very logical. Black goes forward, black advances the pieces. Short castle b6. Black needs to develop all his pieces before he continues his pawn advance. He plans to push the d pawn forward, but first he needs to develop his minor pieces at least. The light squared bishop will be well placed on the long diagonal. I think already at this point Tal planned to attack the white king. He planned to bring the bishop to b7, play d4, then somehow force the trade of the light squared bishop and eventually point out the weakening of the f3 and h3 squares. White proceeded with knight a4. White feels that his knight is misplaced, and indeed white cannot normally bring it to the middle of the board. In the case of knight d3, black seems to win material by means of dc4. It's a discovered attack. Queen attacks the knight. So white tries to find a better square for the knight. Maybe knight can go to c3, or white just keeps it on a4 for a while, restricting black's pawn advance on the queen side. If white leaves the knight on b2, potentially black can expand on the queen side playing b5. So white decided that knight a4 looks better than knight b2. So knight a4, bishop b7. White traded the central pawns. Otherwise, black could play d4. So cd5, ed5, and d3. As you can see, Vasily Smyslov does not go forward so far. He rather tries to restrict the enemy pieces. So playing d3, he prepares to black's play with d4. Now in the case of d4, he can do e4, blocking the black's light squared bishop. And I think white can play e4 even if black does not play d4. So white can try to attack the f5 knight and just bring more pawns closer to the middle of the board. Black proceeded with queen f6. Yeah, so far looks very natural. Black just moves everything out, tries to be closer to the center of the board. White moved his queen to d2. Rook ad8. Both players set up the rooks. Rook fd1. Rook e8, rook b1. So let's just stop for a minute to discuss this position. As for me, the position of black looks better. Black has more space. Thanks to his d5 and c5 pawns, he controls the important plots in the middle of the board. White tries to find a counterplay on the queen side. Playing his last move, rook ab1, white demonstrates that at some point he can consider to push the b pawn forward, a3, b4. And black needs to find a plan. Black looks better, but at the same time, if he sits and waits, white can create a counterplay and improve his pieces, open up the files on the queen side, activate his big pieces that currently doing nothing, I mean queen and rooks. So black should be active. And in the game, Tal played knight d6. I don't think it creates any threat, but he prepares d4. In the case of immediate d4, I think white just planned to play e4. e4 would go with the tempo. So black removes the knight, and this knight also protects the bishop. So in the case of d4, e4, knight d4, the b7 bishop is protected by the knight, and it would benefit black if he can force a trade of these central pawns and open up the d-file for his rook. So black's plan to further advance his d-pawn, and he is ready for d4. White played knight e1. To be honest, the position of white seems to be pretty passive, but again, it's a solid one. And to break through, black should be precise, black should be vigorous, but at the same time should restrict white's potential counterplay on the queen side. d4, black is perfectly ready for this move. e4 and queen e7. Why black moves the queen again? Because he plans to play f5. f5 must be moved for black. Without f5, it's hard to break through. The position is pretty closed. 7 pawns are still on the board. No open files. And black understands that he has a chance to attack the white king. He has a chance to break through on the king side. And f5 would definitely help him to activate his minor pieces, open up the center, and potentially play against the white king. So queen e7, knight c2, and f5. Yeah, black should play f5 as soon as possible. If black does not play f5, white can do his own f4 move. f4 helps white to take control over the e5 square, but another good thing about this move, in the case of black's f5, white can keep the position close playing e5. So for white, it can be crucial to keep the position closed, because otherwise his king can be vulnerable. So f5 should be played as soon as possible. And after white played e5, the most interesting part of the game begins. So if you think that black just played knight takes on f5, you are wrong. So this move actually looks pretty logical, and there is nothing bad about it. But Mikhail Tal does not want to give white extra time to connect his pieces. In the case of knight f5, I think white would play rook e1. Then he can trade the rooks, playing rook e8, and then rook e1, offering another trade. It would help white to simplify the position. I believe black is still better. His pawn chain looks better. a7, b6, c5, d4 looks very nice compared to the white's pawn especially. White also has pretty bad knight, still at the edge of the board. I mean, knight a4, another knight is restricted by the c5 pawn. But if white trades the big pieces, if white trades the rooks, and what's more, if white trades the queens, I think he has pretty good chances to survive, because black just cannot normally attack the white king. And as I said, black was not going to take the pawn. Instead of it, black plays knight e5. It's easy to miss this move if you do not consider alternatives. So always consider alternatives in between moves. It's very important part of a chess game. Many players do not consider alternatives or do not consider enough alternatives. And many of us would play knight f5 automatically just because it looks so natural. Take, retake. And looks like we improve the position. We improve the knight. But knight e5, more concrete move, it creates a threat. Specifically, black wants to trade the light squared bishops and then play queen b7, followed by knight f3. As I said in the beginning of this game, black planned to attack the white king. And yeah, now white should be very precise. White played f4. It's pretty much only move. Otherwise, bishop g2, queen b7 can just checkmate the white king. So f4 and knight f3. So Tao continues playing very vigorously. So it's important for black to get white's light squared bishop because it would point out the weakening of the white king. Black does not count pawns. Indeed, in this position, it does not matter how many extra pawns does white have. What matters is his poor king. So white tries to secure the king after bishop takes on f3. Bishop takes on f3. Smyslov played rook e1. And again, white hopes to simplify the position. Black could play queen d7, queen b7. I believe after any of these moves, black still has some initiative. Black can continue targeting the white king, and he has enough compensation for the pawn because of his better pieces. But Tal is Tal, and he is not ready to retreat the queen. His move was queen e2. It's a queen sacrifice, but if white tries to keep the queen after rook takes on e2, rook takes on e2, he can play, for instance, queen c1. Black seems to have great compensation for the queen. He can continue with rook g2, king f1, and let's say rook takes h2. Knight f5 can be considered instead, but in the case of knight takes f5, white can fork black playing knight e1. So I think Tal planned to do rook h2 instead of knight f5, and it keeps all his ideas with knight f5, rook h1. If black wants to restore the balance, he can play rook h1. Ideally, probably black just wants to bring another rook to the second rank, rook d8, followed by rook e2. So material wise, white is better, but strategically wise, if you compare the pieces, you can see a clear difference. All black pieces, or almost all black pieces, can participate in black's attack against the white king. Knight f5 is coming up, whereas both white's knights are pretty limited. Rook is out of the play, queen doing nothing on the first rank. And yeah, I think Smyslov just did not want to go into this position. It looks very unpleasant, and maybe it was the best bet for white from a practical point of view, but looks very promising for black, easier to play for black, and I believe black has enough compensation. And another thing, I think he just did not expect this queen to move, and as it often happens in chess, when you do not expect something, when your opponent surprises you with unexpected move, you can make a mistake pretty quickly after it. So after rook takes on e2, rook takes on e2, white preferred to give up the queen. Queen e2, bishop e2, and then knight b2. Maybe Smyslov believes that it is just his best chance to play against Mikhail Tal, to go into the end game, and because Tal is a very tactical player, maybe he believes that Tal will be bored, and so White can survive, White can save this slightly worse end game. Actually, the end game, as for me, is much better for Black. Black has a bishop versus knight in an open position. Black has a better pawn chain, and let's see what happened. Black took the pawn back. G takes f5, rook e1, bishop h5, knight c4. Again, seems to be pretty logical from the white's point of view. Knight is doing nothing, and for a weaker side, it can be a good strategy to simplify, to trade pieces. However, after knight takes c4, b takes on c4, rook e8, Tal offers another trade, but it does not mean that it becomes easier for white to defend this position. Black is better. It's a long-term advantage. D3 pawn can be the main weakness for Black's attack. Black can also some progress pushing the queenside pawns forward, b5, potentially b5. Black can advance the king. So after king f1, rook takes e1, king takes e1, king f8. And as usually in the endgame, it's very important to improve the king. King can go to the middle of the board. From the middle of the board, it's easier and faster to go to both sides of the board. So king d2, king f7. These moves seem to be logical as well. And knight e1. Another white's problem in this endgame, his knight is very limited. And white probably tries to bring it to h4 to attack the f5 pawn. But to be honest, knight on h4 does not look so nice. Still, at the edge of the board, it's easy for black to defend the f5 pawn. So I think white just tries to survive. White just tries to build a fortress. Sometimes in such positions, it can be hard to break through for the stronger side. So let's see what happened next. After knight e1, black played a6. As I said earlier, b5 can be a good option for black to expand on the queen side. And after a4, a5. Why a5? Actually, it's a pretty logical move from a strategic point of view. It fixes the white's weakness. It's the pawn that black is going to attack with his light squared bishop. And it restricts white's potential counterplay with a5. So since black cannot play b5, a5 is the best practical chance for him. King c2. The only way to defend the a4 pawn is to bring the king to b3, bishop e8, and king b3. Bishop c6. Bishop is better placed on the long diagonal, and again, white does not have so much counterplay. White sits and waits. King a3, king f6, king b3. Okay, black needs a plan. Black needs to break through in this position. For white, it's just king b3, king a3, back and forth. White cannot make any progress in this position, but black can advance his king. Specifically, black played king g6, and his idea, I think, is pretty straightforward. He wants to bring the king to g4. After he brings the king to g4, king h3 is unavoidable, and if black is able to play these two moves, white should lose all his pawns on the king side, and it will be easy win for black. So white's only chance is to restrict the black king playing h3 before black moved his king to g4. That's what happened in the game. White played h3, but now black moved the king back, and now his plan is to attack the h3 pawn. He is going to attack this pawn with the bishop. Bishop will go to f1 square, and after black forces white's h4, king can go back to g4. And black can afford to play it slowly. Black can prepare his attacks carefully just because white has no counterplay. White's position is very passive and he just watches. So after king g6, king b3, king g7. So black needs to open up the e8 h5 diagonal for his light squared bishop. King a8, king f6. Black could play bishop e8 sooner, or could play king f6 sooner, but again, no hurry. He can do it a move later. And finally, after king b3, black moved his bishop to the right diagonal. Bishop e8. White proceeded with knight g2. White could try knight f3 instead to bring the knight to e5, but after bishop h5, knight e5, bishop d1 check, king a3, black can first move the king to e6 to take control over the d7 square, otherwise knight d7, knight b6 could give white some counterplay. And still, bishop e2, bishop f1, the same plan. Knight on e5 looks nice, but cannot attack anything, so it's pretty empty piece. Nice piece, but non-active piece. Compared to it, the black bishop can easily attack the white pawns. Bishop e2, bishop f1, forcing h4, and let's see. For instance, white plays knight c6, bishop e2, knight e5, and at some point white will be in the Zugzwang. For instance, black can push the corner pawn one square forward, h6, and let's say white moves the king to b3. I think bishop f1 looks pretty good. Bishop f1, h4. Bishop e2, knight cannot move because of the d3 pawn, and after king a3, bishop d1, at some point white should move the knight somewhere, king f6, king g6, king h5, black can advance his king pretty quickly and take white's kingside pawns one by one. So Zugzwang, the main tool that black can use in this position. The white pieces are very limited, and maybe white, we can also try to play g4 for white at some point to make some trades on the king side. So let's go back to the position after black played h6 and try g4 for white. I think again, just bishop d1 and the same thing. White is in the Zugzwang. Knight cannot move because of the g4 pawn. King cannot move because of the a4 pawn. In the case of g5, hg5, fg5, and black just takes a knight. So looks like every move worsens white's position. So it's a classical example of the Zugzwang. So g4 does not help either. Okay, in the game, white played knight g2 instead of knight e5, bishop h5, king c2, bishop e2. So black follows his plan, bishop is heading to f1, white proceeded with knight e1, bishop f1, and then knight f3. Yeah, as we could see earlier, h4 does not help so much. Black could move the king towards the g4 square and attack the g3 pawn, so white tries to bring the knight to g5. Black played bishop h3. It's probably the best move. Alternatively, black could consider to restrict the knight playing h6. But then after knight takes e5, bishop takes h3, king d2. White wants to play knight d7, and in the case of king e6, black is up a pawn, black still better, but I'm not sure that he can break through if white just keeps his king on d1 and d2 squares. It does not allow black to bring the bishop to attack the a4 pawn. So knight on e5 is pretty strong, and looks like it can be hard for black to convert his material advantage in this position. So black just took the pawn on h3, bishop h3, knight g5, bishop g2, knight h7. King g7, knight g5, king g6. Yeah, actually, still hard to believe that black can win this endgame. Yeah, white still has two weaknesses, a4 and d3 pawns, but the white king is able to protect these weaknesses, bishop c6, king b3. But the black king will play the decisive role. The black's main power in this position is his king, king h5, king g4, something that white cannot stop. White played king d2, bishop c6, king c1. Yeah, looks maybe a little bit weird. White does not try to defend the a4 pawn, but king c2, king b3 allows black to advance the king, king h5, king g4. So white tries to find the counterplay, attacking the black pawns. In the case of bishop takes on a4, I think he can plan to bring the knight to e5, knight f3, knight e5, or maybe knight e6. Still, the position should be winning for black, but what is interesting, black does not hurry to take this pawn. He can do it later on. White does not defend it and cannot defend it quickly. Black played bishop g2, and again, I think black could afford to take the pawn immediately, but bishop g2, he does not want white to bring the knight to a better slot and tries to restrict the knight. King d2 was played for white, and king h5. So it's time to move the king forward. In the case of king e2, king g4, king f2, bishop c6, and next move, black will take the pawn. Now, when the white king is far away from the a pawn, black can advance it pretty quickly, and king is already on g4, so this one should be winning for black. White decided to activate the knight, knight e6, king g4, knight c7, probably white's best chance. Knight can go to d5 to attack the b6 pawn. Bishop c6. Black does not want the white knight to cut off the bishop. And after knight d5, black took the g3 pawn. Knight e7, bishop d7. Black wants to keep a pass pawn on the king side, so he first defends it. And then after knight d5, bishop a4 finally, knight takes b6, bishop e8, bishop c6 probably was a better move and more logical one. However, black played bishop e8, knight d5, king f3. So black is up a pawn and the position should be winning. He can take the f4 pawn after the d5 knight leaves. Again, white does not have so many good moves in this position, and at some point he should find himself in a situation of the Zugzwang. So knight c7, bishop c6, knight e6. Again, white's best chance is to activate the knight and try to take some of black's pawns. The c5 pawn cannot be defended. But after a4, knight c5, a3, white does not have enough time to play knight e6 in this position, because after a2, knight takes d4, king f4, knight b3, bishop a4. The only move for white is knight a1. Knight gets stuck in the corner of the board, no knight c2, no knight b3, and black just at some point starts pushing the f pawn forward together with the king. This pawn will be unstoppable. So after a3, black played knight b2, but it's pretty much the same story. a2, king c1, king takes f4. King b2, king e3. Now the f pawn will play the decisive role. The white pieces are just too far away to stop it. White tried his last chance, knight a5, bishop e8, c5. But after f4, c6, bishop takes c6, knight takes c6, f3, knight e5, f2. White just resigned. To stop this pawn, white should play knight g4, but after king e2, knight takes f2, king f2, king a2, king e3 or king e2 should lead to a winning pawn endgame. So white cannot take their position. Even if white can take their position on time, the position is still losing because the black pawn crossed the middle of the board. So the endgame is completely winning for black. Okay, and that's it for today. I hope you enjoyed Tal's vigorous play in the middle game, as well as his excellent endgame technique. It was Nadezhda Kosintseva for chesslectures.com. Thank you for watching.